everyone, welcome to Artists Decoded. This is your host, Yoshino, and welcome to another exciting episode. This is a three-person conversation between me and my friends, visual artists Jesse Draxler and James Hammontree of the industrial metal band Black Magnet. James's project, Black Magnet, came by my desk maybe about a year and a half ago. I think I put off listening to it for a while. And then when I did, I think I was working out and I can just feel the energy emanating out of the record. And I think that was actually when he sent me the demos of the album. But there's this magnetic energy that emanates out of the music that James has. And, you know, you can really tell that it deals with, especially from the lyrics, that it deals with these heavy emotions. But it's also an interesting contrast to when you actually speak with James, which you'll be able to hear on this episode, obviously, because he's such a positive light. And I think I even mentioned this on the podcast, but I had to reschedule on him a couple times, which I didn't feel really great about. But the way that he handled it was just so, I want to say professional, but maybe that's not quite the word. More like he was just very fluid and he was just like, oh, okay, you know, that's not a big deal. And just was very peaceful about the whole situation. It's interesting because you're going to be listening to his music and like stereotypically, you may think that someone who creates this sort of music is dealing with a lot of anger issues or something like that. But I think we really need to have a more nuanced approach. And we talk about this in the episode about this idea of darkness, right? And we also talk about the Kabbalion, which has, if you're not familiar with the Kabbalion, there's seven principles to the Kabbalion. And the fourth principle of the Kabbalion is the principle of polarity. Let me read you directly from the Kabbalion what the, a sentence from the principle of polarity. Everything is dual. Everything has poles. Everything has its pair of opposites. Like and unlike are the same. Opposites are identical in nature, but different in degree. Extremes meet. All truths are but half truths. All paradoxes may be reconciled. And so when it comes to this idea of darkness, I mean, how do we really define darkness, right? Or is it just an energy? Is it a vibration? And some of us are attracted to that. There's this magnetic pull to go into the underworld and to find meaning in the underworld. And I think that James's album, Body Prophecy, really presents that in an eloquent way. I mean, you'll be able to hear for yourself because we're going to be playing a track from his album. But, you know, this industrial metal album, I think, is really special. And if you listen to it in its entirety, you know, even if you're not into this sort of music, I would challenge you to keep an open mind. But so James is actually going to be playing a show with Greg Pusciato of Dillinger's Escape Plan for Greg's solo project. That's coming up on this Friday, November 11th at Don Quixote's in Los Angeles. You can purchase tickets online. And yeah. I hope you like this episode. If you'd like to, please go to our iTunes, leave us a review there, or you can go to our Spotify page and leave us a quick review over there. This next track is off of Black Magnet's newest album, Body Prophecy. The track is called Floating in Nothing. Hope you enjoy it, followed by the interview. Actually, James, I did want to ask you as like kind of like a jumping off point, but I wanted to ask you about your relationship and how you found the Kybalion.
Oh.
And obviously, you know, you have a song on your album, your newest album, called Hermetics. So it's an obvious nod to Hermeticism and those ancient Greek and Egyptian teachings. So I was curious what your relationship was to it.
You know, I actually came across it probably in like maybe early college, late high school, when I was reading Lord of the Rings. And I was going through all the Lord of the Rings books. It would have been like my maybe junior year of high school. And I had like a Tolkien guide that came, or that was like that my teacher was having us read along with the books for like all the references and understanding. And he talks about it, and it's kind of mixed with some of his like pagan stuff into like the stories in there, like some of the lore.
Wow.
Which is pretty cool, which is super weird for, I don't know, that to be in there. But I just remember, seeing like the symbol with like the triangle and the circles on it, and just like thinking it was just a really badass symbol. So I'd kind of remembered it. And then trying to think how I came across it again. I think I'd always known that, oh, you know, it's in one of the first occult books I also ever read was, it's just called The Occult by Colin Wilson. Have you heard of that?
I haven't.
It's really, really good. It's like a, it's like an early kind of, I think it was written in like the 60s, but it's just like a historical reference book for pretty much all like occult stuff up until then. It's really, really, really good. It was like my first introduction to like more stuff than that as far as like occult stuff goes. He has like a whole chapter over Crowley, of course, but like P.D. Ouspensky and just like a whole bunch of different stuff. I'd gotten that, and then I'd also gotten these Man, Myth, and Magic books, which are like, there's like a 12 set edition of them. They're made in the 60s and 70s. And I think I'm pretty sure that Kybalion was referenced in that too. So those three, yeah.
I'm familiar with those Man, Myth, and Magic books. They did like I know there was a magazine, like an actual magazine, because I have copies of the magazine, but then they did like a abridged versions, like in a book form too, or something like that.
Yeah. I didn't even know that there was a magazine. I just have like 7 or 8 of the book editions. I think there's 12 or maybe there's like 24 of them.
I got the magazine and I picked it up because there was like an article about occult arts or so, or like arts or occult in the arts or something like that. It was like basically referencing fine art and occults in the fine arts. But they had like a whole section of Francis Bacon paintings, like and my favorite ones too. They had like the three figures around the crucifixion, which is that weird, orange with like the head, you know, open and just super weird figures and stuff. But they had that in there, and I thought, wow. Super interesting to see a book about like this, like magic and shit, that's like talking about Bacon. So I had to pick that up. And then from there I recognized, oh, a lot of people have these books that kind of float around and use bookstores and Goodwills and shit like that. You come across them every here and there. As I travel the country, I see them here and there. So that's a cool reference, man.
Yeah. Yeah. Those books are amazing. That and probably like that first book I was talking about, The Occult by Colin Wilson, were probably the first two like major introductions into deeper stuff like that. And those Man, Myth, and Magics are insane because they'll go into just like basic stuff like Ring Around the Rosie, like the children's game, and like the occult, like history of that, and just different shit.
What is the occult history on that?
God.
You can remember.
I have to look it up, but it has, let me look real quick.
That's so funny.
It has something to do with like the circle motion. Let me look.
I mean, yeah, it seems kind of twisted. I can see there being some shit there, right?
Yeah, I heard that there's some. I'm not quite sure, but I mean, I've heard.
I mean, it looks like a scene from Midsommar or something, right?
Right.
Yeah. Midsommar. Oh man.
Let's see. Okay, I found an article on it. Yeah, it has something to do with posies, I guess. Which is, I think that's like a flower, right?
Yeah.
They did it to help keep plagues away in medieval folklore, sounds like.
Seems right.
I just pulled out my Man, Myth, and Magic, one of the magazines, and looking at an illustrated encyclopedia of the supernatural. That's great. Yeah, I'll take a photo of this and post it somewhere once this comes out so people can see. But this is awesome. I'm glad you brought this up, man, because I haven't pulled this out and looked at it in a minute.
Man, they're so good. They're just chock full
yeah.
of crazy info. A lot of like the like Haitian and voodoo stuff in there is cool too.
The this article on the arts is rad. They have Dali, they have Bacon, they have Max Ernst. It's called Magic of the Moderns. It's very cool.
Speaking of the Haitian culture, mythologies and voodoo magic and things of that nature, have you guys seen Curse Films?
What is that?
Actually, Mitch, our all mutual friend Mitch Horowitz was on Curse Films, and it's essentially talking about various films like Serpent in the Rainbow is one of them, referencing like Haitian culture and
Okay. What was the name of it again? That movie?
Serpent and the Rainbow.
Or the thing that Mitch was on.
Oh, Cursed Films. They examine
Oh, it's
like.
Cursed Films. I saw the first one that he was on, but I think a second one came out, right?
Yeah, there's yeah, season one and season two.
I watched, I feel like, how many episodes are in each? Because I watched part of the first one.
I think there's like 5 or 6 episodes.
Five or six. Okay, yeah, I watched two or three of them. Yeah, I think I watched the one over, God, they do one over the Twilight Zone movie where someone died.
That one, yeah, it's
And then
pretty
maybe
gnarly.
like The Birds? I can't remember. I watched a couple of them though. I've been meaning to watch those again.
Yeah, they're really they're I had Jay Scheel on the pod, who's the director of that and producer. Anyways, I don't know, you said something about Haitian mythology and
Yeah, it
Serpent in the
like in
Rainbow
those
came up to me.
in those man myth and magic books we were talking about, it has like one of the editions has like a little section over that, which is cool.
Nice.
Yosh, what was Mitch on Cursed Films? I haven't seen these. When did these come out?
I think the first season came out in 2020, and then the second season came out in 2022, so this year.
Yeah, I think that second one was pretty recent.
And they go over movies and shows or something where people died or there was tragedies that happened or something during the production?
Yeah, and like supernatural stuff. Oh yeah, they did one, of course, over the Exorcist.
Yeah, they
That's
did.
the other one I watched.
Exactly. So they did The Wizard of Oz, The Exorcist, Poltergeist, Serpent the Rainbow. Gosh, what was that Tarkovsky film, Stalker?
Oh, Stalker. Yeah, I think that's I didn't finish that one, but I started watching
What
it.
happened during Stalker?
Well, there was certain things around the production of Stalker. Like, a lot of people theorize that Tarkovsky, he died. I think he had some sort of cancer or something, or some sort of disease. And they were saying because the place that they shot Stalker was had some like nuclear fallout.
Oh yeah, it was radiation stuff, kind of like Chernobyl.
Exactly. Yeah. And there was a lot of, I mean, they were kind of like going deep into the swampiness, into the mud, into the trenches, right? And
Well, yeah, that's what the movie looks like. They're going into the nuclear zone. That's what's happening.
exactly. And so like a lot of the crew members, had early deaths, and
Interesting.
yeah, so that was
That's just a sacrifice for the arts. That's how I see that.
Yeah, I mean,
The
Tarkovsky,
movie's worth it.
man, have
God, the movie's so good. It's so good.
real quick, have you guys seen that Woodland's Dark Days, Darkened Days Bewitched, the history of folk horror?
No.
What's
It
that
is
about?
like it's this new like 4.5 hour documentary, and Mitch is in it, and it's all about the history of like folk horror, which kind of what we were talking about. I thought you guys might find that pretty cool. It's that is super worth watching. It goes into like basically from like the, I don't know, like novels that influence like a lot of the like public British broadcasting, like teleplays that were on TV that were influenced by occult stuff, everything from there up until like Hereditary and Midsummer and that kind of thing, like The Witch. And it's like it's seriously like one of the longest documentaries I've ever watched, but it's like a 1-part, 4-hour documentary about like the history of that. Super worth watching.
Hmm.
But it reminded me, is called Woodlands Dark and Days Bewitched, A History of Folklore.
Hmm.
But it reminded me of Curse Films kind of, but it's like only about folklore. It's so, so good. I watched it maybe like a month ago.
Hmm.
And yeah, and Mitch is all throughout it, which is cool.
That's great. Mitch is everywhere lately.
Oh, dude, it's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah. That's cool. I'll definitely have to check it out. Yeah,
I was curious, is there a Cursed Films on The Crow?
Oh yeah. That's in season 2, I think.
Is it? Sick. That's something I'll probably watch right after we get done talking, because that sounds sick. Cool.
It's honestly, I think that series was done so well and with so much consideration for the people involved in each film, and I thought it was just it really captured the story, like the Wizard of Oz story, and for instance like the Tin Man, the first person, I forget what his name was cast as the Tin Man, but they were using, you know, they were using a lot of these experimental techniques that weren't used in film before, and then so they essentially had like this crushed up, essentially toxic, like shards of aluminum, and to use as, you know, for the Tin Man, for his skin. And, it's theorized that, you know, that actor, the first actor, got really sick from using that. And, it actually like caused like an early death or something of that nature.
Whoa, that's insane.
Yeah. So there's like a lot of these, like, you know, it addresses the you know, the Munchkin hanging,
oh,
know,
yeah, yeah, yeah,
thing, and you know, it's
I need
it's,
to watch that episode.
Yeah, it's interesting. But I did want to ask, so you know, specifically James, like as regarding, you know, body prophecy, like I wanted to know like how you two came in contact with each other, and like, you know, Jesse, you know, you did the artwork for Body Prophecy, so I wanted you guys to just kind of talk about that.
James, why don't you go, because you hit me up, if I remember right, how that all started. I'm not sure, maybe we were mutual followers or something beforehand, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, that was it. I can't remember where I'd found your work. I mean, you'd been on a bunch of, you know, you'd done a bunch of album covers, and I think I just emailed you straight up. I think your email was just maybe in your, maybe I'd found your website too. I think I'd found your email through your website. Yeah.
And I'm remembering a little bit now, but like you reached out in an email, and man, so it's kind of funny because the album came out this year, right? 2022. Yeah. But you hit me up in like fucking 2020 or 2019 or something even. Was it pre-pan or post-pan?
I think it might have been pre, because I think that I was recording demos for that album.
So that's insane. Insane, because that's so long in advance. And I think that is what actually played to your advantage with like me being involved, because it gave me a lot of time to just kind of come around to it and just be like, yeah, sure. Like, because you hit me up and then you didn't really have a deadline. You're just really early. And I remember I didn't even like listen to the music at first. And like you kept on it though. You were persistent, which was, but not in like a shitty way. You were just like, cool. And you would talk about other shit, and we started talking about like other mutual interests and shit like that. And then I think it just kind of evolved, and I can't remember if like I made something and all of a sudden I was like, yeah, fuck it, like I have something already, like let's do this, or what it was, but it just kind of happened.
I think I'd been, because I think I'd sent you like a couple of initial demos.
Well, I know listening to the album pushed me over the edge completely, like where I was just like, oh shit, like I was listening to that album before it was mixed. I remember driving Wisconsin in the winter of like 2020, 2021, like the winter 2021 early, and blasting it in like the Jeep that I drive out there, and just being like, this is the fucking best industrial album that's like nobody's heard yet. It's crazy. And it didn't come out for like a year later. You know,
that's,
I was like,
yeah.
Yeah, you know what's really funny is like I kind of have a similar relationship with the album as well, because James, I think you have been listening to the podcast for a while. Is that right?
I have, yeah.
And so, you know, like, you know, I can't even think of how many people hit me up and how many people send me their album or like their artwork or like whatever, right?
Yeah.
And then, you know, and I was like, okay, well, yeah, let me listen to this. And then so I started listening to it and I was like, oh shit, this is fucking awesome. Yeah. Yeah, and you know, I'm sure Jesse, you get like the same thing, like people hitting you up to like listen to their stuff or like to collaborate or
It's gotten over the top to the point of like I can't even respond to everybody. I can't even listen to everything as much as I want to. Like, but yeah, exactly.
Yeah, yeah, totally. Yeah, and then so I know it's interesting too because like, and then I noticed I don't know what stage the album was at. I don't know if it was like James, if you sent me I think you sent me the demos at first.
Yeah, I think I'm trying to think. I might have sent you like something like the pre-mixed version that I had sent to Jesse at first.
Yeah.
Or like, because it, you know, I had like home demos that I recorded with.
Yeah.
And then I had like three different mixed versions that were like a few months spread apart. That was kind of
I was
like,
getting all those too, wasn't I?
That's what I
like,
thought. Yeah.
You were updating me with like mixes and shit. It was awesome. And like, yeah, it was
everything
really
was just
fun.
Taking forever. And I was just like, I want like my close people like that are working on this or that I want to hear it to like, I don't know, it to stay kind of relevant, like, or it to stay present, I guess.
Yeah.
It took like, I mean, I recorded it in August of 2020. So it took almost two years because it came out in September. Yeah, I guess it came out in what, July 29th? Yeah. So 2 years almost to the date after it was recorded. So as far as like people who were involved in the album and just, you know, people like you, Yoshino, that I wanted to send it to, I wanted to get out there before it kind of came out so people could get a feel for it. And it had just been so long.
Mm-hmm.
Let me, yeah. James, like, I'm really curious how you felt about that long of a lead up or having something in the back pocket, holding on to it that long, because I often, when I have to hold on to something so long, it grows stale or something happens to it. It almost becomes like cancerous. Like, it needs to get out of me and it needs to get out there. Otherwise I can't like move on or something. It becomes this block. I'm wondering, like, did you encounter that at all? Or like, how did your relationship to the album change over that course of 2 years of it just being done and not even working on it more? Because I'm sure you wrote more music and now you have more content and you didn't even get to tour it because of the pandemic. What was it that like?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So that was definitely a thing where, because I'd recorded my first album about a year, only like a year and a half. Let me think. April 2019 is when I did the first one. And then I did August 2020 for Body Prophecy. So when I went in to record it, you know, it felt like a normal album cycle. And then like after it was recorded due to pandemic, label funding, not being able to tour, everything, you know, shutting down and getting pushed back. I just kept writing songs. And that was probably the only thing that kept me feeling fresh. But it was, you know, it was like really, really, I guess like the most irritating thing about it is because the album took so long to get out, I felt like for 2.5 or almost really 3 years, my work was only represented by my first album. And by the time Body Prophecy came out, the first album was three and a half years old, you know? And so I felt like I was getting like a lot of good coverage and a lot of good attention and that kind of a thing. But, it was only based off of my first record, and I really wanted the impact of that, of Body Prophecy, to, you know, catch hold of people's attention instead of like people discovering the first one like 2 years later. If that makes sense, they probably would have just discovered Body Prophecy first off.
Hmm. Yeah. Does it feel weird to talk about an album that you wrote like a couple of years ago?
It's funny because it's like, I feel like it's, certain things are like, I kind of have to go back in time in my memory and sort of remember how I was feeling at the time. Even though it's still similar to how I'm feeling now, but, I think it's like one of those things, like, and I've heard a lot of people say it this way. It's kind of like it quits becoming yours once it's kind of out in public, or once it's kind of like finished, not even if it's out in public. Like, I feel like once I left the studio and it was like done getting mixed, and like, especially after the album, after like the album art was done and like the layout and it was like getting sent to be pressed, I was like, yeah, it just didn't really feel like mine anymore. But it was, I think the really cool thing about that is going back and looking at it with like kind of a, I don't know, like a clear mind and like almost forgetting about it and then evaluating it like you would any other album. And I don't know, I think that's, that can be kind of a cool, useful thing in moving forward to the next one even.
Yeah. So then what do you think about it now, looking at it with fresh eyes?
I mean, I like it. I like the art the most. That's, no. But
the art is awesome. I want a t-shirt.
Oh, totally. Yeah. They're actually getting printed this week, which I'm really stoked about. Yeah. Nice. Yeah. We're doing like a long sleeve and a short sleeve.
Nice.
But yeah. Yeah. So, let me think, going back to your question, Jesse. I never felt like the songs really grew stale. I just kind of like, it was like not being able to tour and play them live really for a couple years. Cause I had to cancel. Like, I had a new booking agent. We had like a 3-week US tour booked. And it was going to be with some like good bands. And the record Body Prophecy was going to come out, or I had like funding from my label to go ahead and record it. And then when the pandemic hit, the tour for the first album got canceled. So I was able to, the cool thing about that was I was able to go record Body Prophecy a lot quicker. But then after Body Prophecy was recorded, there was obviously no tour for that. All the pressing plants were shut down. You know, it was just labels didn't have any money. No one was booking shows, got dropped by a tour agent. You know, they had to get a different job, that kind of thing. So I feel like I just kind of had to like put it out of my mind and just keep writing and just, you know, like kind of how everyone felt in the pandemic, I'm sure, just like doing what they can do to not get freaked out by the future.
What, I was going to ask, like, what song do you think is the most personal?
Man, they're all pretty personal. Probably the song that means the most to me is Floating in Nothing or Incubate. Those are probably the most like reflective and successful at communicating my feelings, I would say, for sure.
That's a great gauge for success.
I think so. Yeah.
I have a question about, like, maybe this had something to do with how long you had with it, but like, how did you get in contact with, Justin?
Oh man, that's a pretty cool story. So,
wait, for context, who's Justin?
Yeah. Sorry. Justin K. Broadrick, me and James, I know are huge fans of, I'm a fan of his entire breadth of work. Well, I can't really say that, to be honest, because I haven't really listened to Jesu and I don't know if that would be my thing. But as far as like Godflesh is fucking one of the best bands fucking ever. JK Flesh, like everything he does is JK Flesh is fucking amazing.
Yeah.
All the production he does for like, you know, with Vatican Shadow and all that shit. Like, I'm just a huge fan of him in general. And then I read interviews with him and he's super dope. Like, he's a true artist. He's a true musician. Like, he's just like somebody to look up to as a creative, in my opinion. And I feel, James, you feel the same way. So
oh,
I think
100%.
So like when I saw like, holy shit, like I'm doing an album cover and it's going to have a Justin K. Broadrick remix on it. For me, that was something. So I'm just really curious how it came about.
Yeah. 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 Justin is super prolific, you know, like he's been at it. He was one of the first guitar players in Napalm Death.
I totally forgot that too.
So yeah.
It's like the biggest thing. And to me, it's like the most uninteresting, but it's like super awesome. Of course, Scum is a fucking insane
masterpiece,
album. You know?
Yeah. Okay. So, my engineer that had done my last two albums, his name's Sanford Parker.
Shit. And I met him, right? Didn't I meet him?
Oh yeah, you did. I forgot about that. Yeah.
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 Dude.
So him and Sanford were kind of buddies, and they had done a couple of remixes in the past. They did a remix for a band called Harm's Way, which is like
oh my god,
yeah. And then And then they did something, I forget what else they did. I think they did another track, but they did tracks separately and then they did a track together, like kind of like doing a remix, like back and forth on one song, which is cool.
Who's this, Harm's Way and JK?
I think it was Harm's Way, yeah, and Justin Broadrick, yeah.
Oh, wow, that's sick.
So I think that that's kind of how they got in touch. But, you know, Sanford's, I mean, he's recorded everything from like I Hate God to, you know, all of like a lot of the Neurosis side projects and that kind of thing. He's just like a really big metal engineer. He did a bunch of the Yob albums, just tons. So I think they were familiar with each other a little bit before then. But Sanford got asked, I think by maybe it was the Chicago Reader to interview Justin Broadrick. And so they did like a full spread, like full page interview. And that interview is really, really, really good. So
the Chicago Reader too. Wow. Where does Justin live? Is he Midwest? Is he around there?
No. Do you mean Sanford? Justin?
I mean, Justin.
No, he's in England. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Duh. Of course I knew that. So like, that's just really interesting. Like the Chicago Reader would do an article on him.
I know. I think it was maybe because it had something to do with maybe that Harm's Way release, but you know, Sanford.
Maybe. Like, yeah. Because Harm's Way is Chicago. And
Sanford's kind of like a Chicago, you know, legend, I guess, whatever.
Yeah. So. Word. Okay. And, I know Luca writes for the Chicago Reader too.
Yeah.
Luca,
Annihilus. That's right.
Yeah. Okay.
He did a really nice feature when Body Prophecy came out too, which was super cool.
Nice.
But yeah. So they had done that interview and a couple of remixes, and like you had mentioned, Justin Broadrick, like I think, yeah, mixed and mastered, and then maybe did a Vatican Chatter remix, which that record had come out on the same label as my label, 20 Bucks Spin. And so Dave, the owner of 20 Bucks Spin, was kind of in touch with Justin as well. And I think everyone just started talking and kind of connecting the dots. But I had actually emailed Justin just like on the side, and he sent me just a nice message, you know, saying he'll check it out or whatever. And then it just kind of all started happening. So,
wow, man, that's awesome. And
he
I guess
seems super nice too.
I read the interview that he did in Wire. He was on the cover of Wire a few months ago.
I've still been meaning something. To read that one.
Yeah, it was really good. I love everything he says. Like, he's just such a cool dude, it seems like. But that's a cool story. And that's interesting that Vatican Shadow, that's right, that album came out on 20 Buck. Is that the Twin Pillars of the Gasoline Era or some shit like that?
I think so. Let me look.
Because
when my first album, Hallucination Scene, came out, Vatican Shadow's first one on 20 Bucks Spin came out. And has he had a second one?
I don't think so. I was just going to ask, is there only one on 20 Buck?
I think it is just that one. Yeah. And it came out maybe like right before or right after mine. So they kind of got a lot of coverage at the same time. Yeah.
I always come across that one in the record stores because 20 Buck will, it's better at like their distro or something, you know, or like, I think to get a lot of that Vatican Shadow stuff is difficult to get, which is, I know like the one Vatican Shadow album, what is that one called? Media in the Service of Terror or something like that?
I think so, yeah.
That album's like, what I would get for that on vinyl, but that's like hundreds and hundreds, I think.
And I'm sure like he put that out under Hospital, maybe.
Yeah, man, anytime I come across Hospital shit in record stores, I just buy it. I just like, whatever, right, this is going to be sick.
that Alberic album on, well, there's a couple, but that last one that was on Hospital is unreal. If
Word.
You check that out, yeah.
No, I haven't yet. I will definitely check it out.
But yeah, so and then like, you know, Justin asked me what song I want him to remix, and I was like, man, just pick one, like whichever one you feel connected to the most, you know. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
And which song was that?
It was Incubate. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And I'm gonna ask, how long did it take him to turn around for you? Like,
maybe like 10 days. He did it so fast.
Awesome. That makes me like him so much more, man.
Yeah.
I hear horror stories of people asking for remixes of people, you know, like their homies that are like in big bands or something. And they just months and months. And it's like, dude, come on. Like, I need this actually. To hear he got back on that 10 days. That's my kind of dude.
Totally. And he sent me like 3 or 4 drafts and was like,
wow,
you know, like, which one do you like? Whatever.
Yeah. I mean, Yosh, I don't know if you're familiar with him or how well, but to like, he's legendary. He doesn't need to be doing that shit. That's why that's super fucking awesome.
And he did it like for a not what he could have asked for, probably, too.
So cool.
That was pretty cool. Yeah.
That's
yeah,
really cool.
I hadn't been familiar with him, but I'm on my other laptop. I was looking him up a bit and seeing all the projects he's attached to. So I'll have to take a deeper dive.
Yeah. Take a deep dive, because once you do, you can see like the thread that runs through all of it. Like he's got a certain thing about his particular vision of what he's doing that runs through it all, even if it doesn't seem like it at first. James, would you agree? Kind of like,
oh, 100%. And like even in the Yaesu stuff, for sure. I mean, it's a lot more kind of like melodic singing shoegazy type stuff, but, it definitely has like, I don't know. It just has there's just like any good, you know, artist, there's just a good, like a consistent thread through it all that makes you feel like you're listening. You can only get that feeling when you're listening to him.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, if you want the feeling like of his stuff, you can only listen. Like, that's the best. Like, I love it. I like keep his stuff all together in one space, even though it doesn't all sound the same. It's like, but that's the vibe. What I wanted to ask James, what you thought that is, kind of what his thing is, because to me, he's got the like UK garage dubby kind of thing that I really like that runs through like almost everything, even like that Napalm Death shit in the beginning, almost, you know, like they were into reggae and dub and shit like that, which is super unique, especially in the style. They're like, Godflesh is then given a title of like almost a godfather of nu metal. I've read that somewhere, which I thought was hilarious because they're not, but I get it, because it was so bass heavy and like it's so groovy. And you and I were just writing the other day like about Love and Hate, the album particularly, and you're like, this album's like hip hop. I'm like, dude, I know. Like, I'm jamming to it. Like, it's a rap album or whatever.
That's a really underrated one, I think, too. And I think like he started catching a lot of flack from like the metal community or whatever for, you know, getting into more like dub and garage, and or I guess garage is, I think, how they
is that how you pronounce it?
Yeah, I think for that style is garage, but which is funny. But going back to that, like that being like a really UK way to do it, I think that is something that probably was really culturally inspired by, you know, him growing up in England, as far as just like how big dub and reggae and that kind of stuff, also electronic music too, but how big that kind of stuff was in England. You know, if you think about like early ska or a rude boy type stuff, you know, like that is like a huge, that's like almost what classic rock is to America. You know, there it's like such a big rich history, and I feel like that influenced a ton of just like 80s and 90s kind of metal and goth in a way, or at least the people who are involved in it. And I feel like he maybe had his finger on that a lot more than other people too.
It seems super advanced.
Yeah, definitely. And it's just like, you know, just like any other good artist, he's probably into like a shit ton of different stuff, you know? So it's like, you can't be scared to let everything creep in sometimes.
Yeah. Speaking of that, what would you say are some of your like major musical influences?
Oh man. Like as far as like being like a little off kilter or kind of more direct or both,
whatever comes to mind.
Man, I would have to say, God, I'm trying to think back like maybe chronologically,
or not even musical influences, but just influences in general, like disparate elements.
I mean, probably, you know, of course I got into like Slayer and Metallica when I was like 10 and 11 kind of thing. But I would say what probably took it in a more, I don't know, outsider art direction would probably be the band Killing Joke. That I heard at a pretty young age, and that made a huge, huge impact.
Nice.
That, yeah, Killing Joke is definitely a big one. But I mean, really, before I even knew a lot of, you know, more obscure music, I mean, Godflesh was honestly a huge one at first, because I heard that probably when I was like 13 or 14, from my cousin's friend. But it was, you know, I had initially gotten into like, you know, the Ramones and punk and Slayer and Metallica and that kind of stuff. And I had heard, I'd heard Killing Joke, which I thought was amazing. And then I'd gotten into The Birthday Party, Nick Cave's first band. And there was something about those two bands that were like obviously like the weirdest stuff I had heard up until that moment. Mm-hmm. or up until that moment. Yeah. And I just remember in my mind being like, okay, these are two of like the weirdest things I know about. Like, I'm going to make this as important as like the Ramones or Black Flag or Minor Threat. Like, this stuff is my new focus, you know, like this is my Black Flag. This is my, yeah, I don't know, Van Halen at this point now. Yeah. And yeah, so I would say those two, you know, and I mean, a lot of it was just like finding the weirdest stuff I could get my hands on. And even like getting into going back to like art, and we were talking about Francis Bacon a second ago. I remember I'd gotten some type of, it was like an art history VHS set from the library when I was, yeah, nice. 13 or 14. And, that's awesome. And they covered Francis Bacon and Eraserhead in like the last part of this art history, like on like the third edition. It had like gone from like, you know, like early cave paintings up until like modern art pretty much. And I remember it ending with like a Francis Bacon and David Lynch kind of, and stuff that was surrounding that. And then like thinking like, okay, this is like more weird stuff. Like I have to like hunt down and figure out like what it is. So, yeah, I mean, stuff like that was huge, huge into just, you know, figuring out how to dig into deeper layers. And yeah, I would say stuff like that, Killing Joke, Birthday Party. I pretty soon after that found out about stuff like Big Black, which was another awesome Chicago sort of industrial band. It was Steve Albini's band. And that became a huge, huge influence for me in like my early teens. Trying to think of some other just weird stuff. I got really, really into like stuff like Lightning Bolt and just a lot of like noise and power electronics stuff. Mm-hmm. And even it was kind of even before I could really understand it, I just knew that there was something so far separated from what my friends were into or what anyone I knew was into that I felt like if I stuck with it and kind of made it like an influence and part of my repertoire, I could potentially gain knowledge from it and create something that was different from what everyone else was doing, because that stuff was so different from everything else I'd known. So yeah,
that's a good way to look at it.
Yeah. That was kind of like, I just remember like, even before I liked a lot of it, just like suffering through like, there's something here that nothing else has. And that's more important than just the pure pleasure of me like watching, like enjoying it, or like watching like an action movie or whatever, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, James, like you just hit on exactly what I was going to bring up and ask you about, because I totally relate to this practice of, so I do it still, like finding things that I know that there is something there, but even my, like, I know something's there, but my taste isn't drawing me to it. You know what
I
mean?
Right.
But then ignoring taste and being like, well, fuck my taste. Something's there and I need that. I want that, or it is valuable to me, or I'll find the value in that. And then I get turned around and I end up loving these things and finding all new outlets and streams of creativity. And so you just hit the nail on the head for me right there that I was going to ask you about, because
it still
happens to me all the time where I'm just like, I have to like that. I'm going to make myself like that. Sometimes I like an album cover enough that I'm like, there's something like, even if, you know what I mean?
Oh, totally. 100%. Yeah. And sometimes it can be reverse. Like, I'll get recommended an album and like, I hate the cover. I hate like all this stuff about it. But I hear it, I'm like, holy shit. Like, don't look at the cover anymore. Like, you know, just listen.
Or sometimes it just turns into that, like, oh, now there's charm in that shittiness.
Oh, totally. Or something, totally,
you know?
Totally.
Yeah. I get you. Yeah. But yeah, I think that's such an interesting practice. It's really cool to hear you vocalize it that way. And I totally relate.
And like, I just remember like, you know, like going to, there was a really, really good record store close to where I grew up, and the guys that owned it were like super nice. And they were like, you know, like not into run of the mill music, much like most people that own record stores, but they were just like, you know, showing me everything from like, yeah, like British power electronics noise to like West Memphis, like DIY rap stuff, you know, like, everything from like 3-6 to like, you know, like Kingpin, Skinny Pimp, and like a bunch of the more like rare, obscure hip hop stuff, and just mixing everything and being like, but like, I guess what I gained from them is all the stuff they were showing me were so extreme in their own ways that there was like almost like a concurrent thread through it all that was like, wow, you guys are showing me the most weirdest stuff out of everything. Like, I have to make that kind of my filter and my standard now for what I'm, how I don't know, digest music and also like what I crank out as well, if that makes sense.
Yeah. No, that totally makes sense. Yeah, it's interesting. Like when you guys were talking about this stuff, or, you know, I was thinking about kind of that suffering. I mean, just thinking of that word in general, but I remember when I was 12, I watched Eyes Wide Shut. I was like 11. And I remember, Jesus. I was like, what the fuck is this movie?
You know, it's a great one.
Yeah.
Maybe not for 11.
Yeah. Maybe
no. Yeah. I don't even understand how that happened.
Yeah. Well, I mean, how it happened is, you know, like, your parents bring you to the video store and, and you know, I picked whatever movie I wanted to see, and they didn't, you know, they didn't really monitor it.
Okay. So, oh, great. So there's sex, like, cults and shit. That's great.
It's great for, like, you know, 11, 12 year old. But
wow,
I guess.
See, I had an early one like that. It was with Akira. Akira was probably like the first fucked up extreme thing I saw, maybe at like 10 or 11, you know.
Oh yeah. That's a good one.
But then I soon after, maybe when I was 11 or 12, saw Eraserhead.
Oh wow.
And my mom had kind of known what it was, but like I wasn't like allowed to watch or anything, and she caught me watching it. And I remember she said, "You're never going to have kids, are you?" After watching.
Wait, what? Why?
Because of like the baby in that movie.
Oh.
In Eraserhead.
I see.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. That's interesting. Yeah.
But anyway.
I wonder what it is like specifically about like Francis Bacon and David Lynch and some of these like more obscure. I mean, they're like probably the most popular out of like the artists that I would deem to be anywhere in obscurity. But like, is, you know, like I just think about, I've been thinking a lot about just like energy and like, you know, speaking of hermetics, right? And kind of, I guess this energy that we put out and how it manifests like within our consciousness or just manifests within our lives. And I think about that in terms of like, you know, the attraction to like Francis Bacon and David Lynch and, I don't know, perhaps it's like, you know, feeling seen or something, or like feeling understood when you feel like you, I mean, even with music, you know, like listening to more obscure music and stuff, like there's a certain language to it that I think attracts people, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's something to be said about, getting excited about art where there seems to be like a lot of unseen stuff or like a lot of untapped stuff. And I think that can relate a lot towards, you know, when you're making work and you're an artist, you're always wanting to move forward. And there's kind of like a lot of wealth of information in work that deals with unseen and unknown territory. And I think that that's maybe what specifically those two artists for me really, really, tap into.
Hmm.
Yeah. Versus just like a pastoral painting of, you know,
sure,
David and Goliath.
Well, I think something about their work too, is it feels like they've tapped into their own source.
For sure. Yeah. I love that.
For sure. Yeah. Yosh, like what you were saying earlier reminded me of something I saw again recently, but this idea that beauty is a frequency, you know, or something like that, where it's like these different images vibrate in different ways, and like different people are going to be more receptive to different images based on that. Like it's as simple as like saying taste, right? Taste is a frequency or something, or your taste is your frequency, that, you know, the things that vibrate on that frequency are going to be to your taste liking or something. It reminds me of what you were saying earlier. And I think artists like Francis Bacon and David Lynch and stuff like that are like on similar frequencies, you know?
Totally. Yeah. And I've been thinking about that in terms of like these certain decisions that we make, you know, whether we decide to tap into like higher vibrations, you know, higher frequencies or like lower frequencies, you know, and I would, you know, just the way that I think about it, it's like a higher frequency would be something that's closer to the source of like your, I don't know, purpose or like, you know, something that resonates highly with you. Sometime when you feel in flow and you have that energy and like you give your energy to like something that you really, that gives you life, right? That, and then I think about these like lower vibrational entities or lower vibrations in general and just kind of like, you know, maybe that could be like drugs or alcohol or, you know, whatever it may be, or things that take you away from obtaining that source, you know? And I think that perhaps, especially, you know, nowadays, you know, because we live in such a time of like utter discursive thinking and distractions, that like to be able to see people that can tap in, you know, like kind of like what you guys were talking about, Justin Broadrick, you know, it's just like he emanates this certain like life force like within different genres of music, you know, but it's all like kind of signature if we're talking about artists. And also with like, you know, I think about like Alejandro Jodorowsky or like, you know, David Lynch or like, you know, Francis Bacon or whoever, right? I think they're tapped into that certain vibration, right?
That's to why. Me, it's like, and what we're talking about with all of those artists is I just see like and I don't know any of them personally, but it seems like there's such a strong level of honesty, just that are in their DNA. Like they would rather not make art if it was going to be dishonest, you know?
Totally.
And I think that is probably what made, you know, especially stuff like Lynch and Jodorowsky, like so groundbreaking for the time.
Totally. Well, I mean,
and I think it was their honesty, and it's also just, I think, reflective out of breaking out of, you know, whatever cultural background or time period that they were in. And I think that's why it's so powerful. And yeah, it's like important to evaluate, you know, along with it.
Totally.
It's what something that you were saying, Yosh, is interesting to me about this high and low frequencies, and because a lot of people would look at those artists and their work and think of it as low frequency or negative frequency or whatever, because it's dark and it's it may be off-putting to people. It might not make people uncomfortable. Their work makes people uncomfortable. Those people would probably say, like, wouldn't understand you saying that this is high frequency vibrations, you know, like this is high vibes right here. Well, you know what I'm saying?
No, I totally know what you're saying. And, you know, to bring it back to Hermeticism, I mean, you know, if you look at like the third and the fourth and the fifth principle of Hermeticism, you know, the third is the principle of vibration, right? So it's kind of what we're talking about. Everything vibrates. And the fourth principle is the principle of polarity, right? So like understanding that there's a paradox that exists within just life in general, right? And to be able to reconcile to reconcile that juxtaposition within your head, right? And then so if you think about like David Lynch, for instance, I mean, like you would think about like a meditation teacher, right? And then so there's kind of like in a caricature for what that may be. And I think a lot of people would potentially want to like embody that sort of caricature, so they go around prancing around saying they're this spiritual guru or meditation teacher or whatever, right? But then like Lynch talks about how transcendental meditation is such a big part of his being, right? But then you would look at his work and it's almost antithetical in a way. But at the same time, I think that because you can deal with these sort of like darker, deeper emotions, you go into the underground and then you can come, you know, it's cyclical, right? So like it's not marketing.
Well, and like,
you know what I mean?
Like something for me that I've always thought was, you know, unique about a lot of like super prolific artists who are, you know, looked at as like dark or like lower frequency or like that kind of thing or low brow or whatever, is like there has to be not just a little one, but like such a small or such a large level of, you know, optimism for them to keep creating, even if the work is like dark or whatever. Like creating in itself is, you know, is vibrating high, you know.
Absolutely.
In its
like,
own.
And, yeah, 100%. And yeah, this, like, it comes, yeah, and it comes to like this thing that I've been thinking as we're speaking about how, like, taking that good, bad connotation off of these things completely is right. Kind of what it always comes back to. Like, for me, it's like, I don't think
and that's
of,
like a hermetic principle too, you know?
Well, yeah, totally. I mean, I've done that over the last, you know, decade of my life, kind of systematically have tried to do that, but in art, particularly in like my work or whatever, and like, getting rid of the stereotypes that are kind of implanted of like good, bad within these systems where they shouldn't be, where that shouldn't be a qualifier. You know what I mean?
Right. Totally. And that's the whole, like, that's what's fun about art and music and anything, you know, anything yeah. creative is like, that's where you let go of that shit.
Yeah. Well, I mean, even if you look at a band like Meshuggah, for instance, like they're one of the tightest, you know, one of the tightest bands that you could potentially see live, you know, and, but like to an outsider that, you know, depending on your level of consciousness towards like music and whatever, but like, I mean, they would probably, you know, think of it as like erratic or like, you know, whatever.
Right. Yeah, James, you and I have talked about them before, but I wasn't a huge fan until I saw him live. But Blood Incantation is kind of the same. Like, you could, yeah. Like, that dude in Blood Incantation, what does he go by? Like, Bentmore? Or like, anyways, that motherfucker, yeah, like, Jesus was, Christ, he's like a fucking, the dude's like fucking Beethoven or some shit on a guitar. Like, it's insane. But then, like, honestly, the screaming dude. And whatever.
yeah I mean, it's like, yeah, it's funny, like, especially in like those types of instances where you're looking at someone who, you know, could probably play circles around anyone at any concert hall or orchestra in like any city, but is, you know, playing death metal kind of thing. And
mm-hmm. Yeah, it's so interesting and cool, and he's the real deal. You can tell when you see him live, especially because like these dudes are all wearing the bullet belt still and shit. Oh, yeah. It's like, whoa, dude, like, where I was watching them play, and I think like two or three of them all had them on. I'm like, all I could think was, where do you even get a bullet belt anymore? Like, do you make these things? Like, what the fuck, where do you get a bullet belt?
They made their own.
And those dudes are just so versed in their craft, you know, and that it's like, yeah, they're always like, yeah, either wearing shirts or like posting, like, you know, this obscure Swedish death metal band, you listen to the tape and it just sounds like dog shit, but it's like their top 10 favorite album, you know, like,
totally,
which is cool. Yeah.
It's, well, always, I mean, that is interesting, like, when people take the, when they choose that path, when, you know, like, they could be a surgeon, that, you know what I mean, it's like they're working, yep, totally, in a village just helping the locals when they could be the best surgeon in the world making tons of money. Yeah. You know, like, somewhere along there was choices made, and I'm super curious about that kind of shit. Anyways, I think I interrupted you, Yosh.
Oh no, I wasn't gonna say anything necessarily important. I guess I was just gonna point to both your guys' works and speaking about like the higher vibrations, you know, like, I mean, from an aesthetic point of view, I mean, even, you know, like James, like reading some of the lyrics, I'm like, oh man, this deals with some like deep, dark, you know, sort of like dark nights of the soul, you know, but,
right.
But when I talk to you, you know, you're like such a kind, I mean, I've rescheduled on you a couple of times, you know, and like, you know, you're just like such a kind dude, you know, and Jesse, I mean, your work, like, I mean, someone could potentially see that as, you know, being like, I don't know, dark or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
But
I want to piggyback on what you just said about James, because that what you're saying is so true. Like, he is like the most positive, optimistic, high vibe guy, like, around. I've hung out with him in person in Chicago and had a great time. But like, we've been chatting through DMs and texts or whatever for years, like I said, and he's always positive and he's always like hyped about shit, which is rare. Most people are jaded by the time they're in James' position, but he doesn't come across that way at all. He's always like, what are you listening to lately? I'm so stoked on this band. And it is like the coolest thing. But I had the same experience when I read the lyrics, because he sent those along with stuff a long time ago. And it's like really dark and like, you know, he's guilt tripping himself and saying, you know, it's really, yeah, it's really fucking dark, and you're not that person. So it is. I'm glad you brought it up, Yosh, this this interesting dynamic.
Yeah, but I think it's also, you know, I think things get very dark when you don't address the darkness within. You know, like if you don't have a place to put it, you know, if you don't have like people talk to about it, or if you don't have like a medium, you know, to express it in, or however you may deal with those sort of like emotions and those feelings, like I feel like that's when the darkness turns into, I don't know, something incredibly negative, right? Like manifesting in a negative way, right? But I think because you do have a positive creative project, or, you know, something that you can work on, I think, and it also makes people feel seen, I think, in a certain way too, because it's like, oh, I'm not the only one, right? If you read the lyrics and that sort of thing.
Yeah, totally. Well, first of all, thank you for that compliment. I think staying, you know, as optimistic and almost just like proactive on top of my optimism and just outlook is super, super vital to making my work, and whether it's dark or light or happy or whatever. So I definitely focus on trying to, you know, maintain a level of optimism in order for me to keep creating, because that's what makes me happy. And I think like so much of, you know, so much of making honest work is diving into areas which you feel like you can write a lot about and you can do a lot with. And there's like a big, yeah, like there's a big source of material to draw from. And anytime I'm, you know, creating something, I really, really try to dial in the part of, you know, my mind or my creativity or my source that I think I can gain a lot of information from, and gain a mm-hmm. lot of inspiration, and find a place where I don't think that the well will run dry when I'm, you know, dealing with something. Mm-hmm. Kind of hunting down what will keep my development going and keep my creativity going and keep my imagination going, and just trying to take that to the ultimate extreme of how I can remember it and how I can pull from it and how I can like make it a part of my day-to-day outlook, kind of a thing. Even if it's negative, you know, it's like it feels better to deal with it through something than not deal with it at all or not ever think about it, because then when you're done with it, you're kind of like done with it, and there it is, whether, you know, for better or for worse almost.
Yeah, of course.
If that makes sense.
That makes total sense.
Yeah. This is a quote, and I think that Mitch had said it before, but it was evaluating all circumstances based on their potential for development. And mm-hmm. that really, really strikes a chord with me with, you know, choosing what I want to write about or what I want to sing about or what I want to cover, what territory I want to go into is, yeah, seeking the elements that'll give me the most development as an artist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And yeah. And as a person as well, you know, being able to, figure out, how do I say it? Lean into like the things that'll help you develop as a person as well. Yeah.
Totally. Totally.
Yeah.
But you know, like dealing with dark subject matter, I don't think, you know, it's kind of like what we were talking about. Like, I think that if, you know, if anyone was like truly, truly like extremely pessimistic, then they wouldn't have the ability to keep making work and keep making like work that hopefully vibrates on like a higher level and that goes somewhere and does take you places and does, you know, reach out to other people. So yeah, that's something, I don't know. That's something that it's like making dark shit can make you excited about keep living and keep making more of it. You know, I don't know.
No, I get you. It's such like, you James, probably, maybe you feel, what's that? Go ahead.
Oh, I was just saying, like, maybe you kind of feel the same way with a lot of like the subject matter you deal with, Jesse.
Yeah, like it's something that has come up a lot, like I guess in my career and shit like that. And I'm just so tired of it. Like, honestly, I'm so fucking tired of this idea of like dark whatever, dark art and dark this and dark that word fucking dark all the time, you know, like I like it. I like the word and it's like when it's used right. But like this, I just am so tired of it. It's just like, it's so boring. It's like, it also like what isn't like people, dark or like, well, right? Just flip that concept. Just use like, I don't know. Like, I don't think of darkness as like this as darkness or what people think of as darkness. It's such a weird thing. I don't even know how to talk about it anymore. Honestly, it's like, what even is that? Like, what's the void? The void is where everything is. Like the void, what was there before everything? The void, like, how do you even like talk about it? I'm just sick of it. I'm bored. Like, do you get sick of this idea of like dark 100%. Art?
Because for me, it's just like, it just makes me think that so many people are just being dishonest with how they're evaluating real life. It's like,
yeah, there you go. Know, like, there it is. Like, yeah. Like, I go to Walmart and I'm like, this is fucking
this
dark.
This is fucking dark.
Like, this
dude.
Is the darkest shit I've ever seen. Dude, I'm at Walmart in 21 Palms or whatever that fuck that town is before Joshua Tree. That is the darkest place on earth right there. Like, dude,
you
the
drive
creatures
across the
of the desert. Oh.
You drive across the country and all you fucking see are like Starbucks and Arby's and, you know, like just the darkest shit. Yikes. And like, that's like, and then just like, you know, like shitty smiling families in a fucking gas station buying like massive racist trucker hats. Like that's fucking dark.
That's not dark. Like, when I'm flying over, like flying into Chicago or anywhere really, and you go through the suburbs and you see just all the same houses, just one after another, going in patterns around. And in my head, that Weeds theme song just plays like little boxes, little boxes made a ticky-tacky song. And I just, to me, that's so dark. Like, yeah, I see it like every time. I'm just like, this is the,
like,
I sometimes take a photo of it. And when I look at the photo, I'm just like, this is just so goth. Like, it's so American gothic.
See, and like going back to like, you know, stuff like Lynch or Bacon, like, yeah, maybe that does come off dark in like an instance, but it's also like, there's such a level of like honesty with that work that it's liberating and it's like, you know, it's like freeing kind of a thing. Like,
yeah,
I don't know, you know, and it's like,
well, and how can it be dark when it's something that is like so guttural and real inside of every single person? Like, it's not novel to anybody. It's like, we all live that, like, it's not dark. It's just real or it's just the fact.
And it's just like, how can you be in denial about this stuff to begin with in your day-to-day life, but then like you're going to come into like an art world or music world and be still in denial about like aspect of people's insides, people's souls.
And
you
that's
know?
So, and, yeah, that's so true about the denial too, because it goes back to even like how Western society deals with death, you know, on a bigger scale, society in general, and like how we like, I don't know, I think about death all the time. I think, and I don't, and that's not a negative. When I say that, people are like, aw. And I'm like, no,
right?
What the fuck,
same,
man? It's not. Like, why'd you just make that stupid noise? Like, it's fine. It's cool. You know, like, but it's that kind of same thing.
Well, for me, like touching on that is like, there's something so exciting about, like what excites me about making art, kind of what I was touching back on earlier, is like finding things that are unknown or untouched, and like dealing with death related stuff has that almost that flavor to it. And,
oh, bro, right? Because death is the fourth dimension, right?
Exactly. And it's like, yeah, it's scary, and yeah, it's like dark.
That's Hellraiser, by like, the way.
Oh, is that? Fuck yeah. Man, by the way, the new one was so good, I thought.
Oh, really? Wait.
Yeah.
Where can you see it?
I think it's on Hulu. I think it was
yeah,
a Hulu original.
Exclusive.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
I like it. I give it 8 out of 10.
I liked it. Yeah. I saw a lot of like the old heads didn't like it for whatever, you know, for reasons like, but I think that they expanded on the story in a way a lot better.
Apparently
than
Clive
most
Barker really liked
sequels.
It too.
Yeah. Most of the sequels are trash, but like,
oh yeah. They're so
I like the concept quite a bit.
Oh,
like,
me too.
But
yeah.
What I didn't like though, were the characters of like the kids. Like they made them too.
Oh yeah. They were so bad. And they were too like disconnected from each other, I thought.
And yeah. Mm. And they were too like, they were too now. It was too trendy now. Like that it's not a timeless movie. You know, it's like it's now a movie. And that kind of bothered me. But the Cenobites were fucking cool. I can't deny that.
Oh yeah. Everything about it, like the effects and just like this plot was cool.
Yeah. Yeah, like the effects and now like the fucking graphics, everything was fucking, it's very cool. I went back and then watched the first Hellraiser again, and it was even better than I even remembered it.
Yeah,
but in that, I think it's the second one or the first one. Anyways, it's the second one. When he breaks into that dude's place and he's going through his shit, he finds some papers that says death, the fourth dimension. And I'm like, yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Okay. Yeah, that's sick.
I like that.
Going back to that, I mean, like, sweet, you know, book. Like, right?
Yeah.
I feel like that even touches on, like, we just got super stoked about talking about Hellraiser, right? Well,
and that's like, and also too, like, Hellraiser is kind of based on this concept. Like, the dude who wants the puzzle box is interested in this concept of, like, it does pleasure and pain. And in that movie, it has the line, yep, pleasure and pain indistinguishable. And I'm like, and yeah, like, I get that, you know?
It's an extreme unknown, you know, and that's like
in both directions. Like, always, like, he doesn't care if it hurts or if it feels great. Exactly. Either one is the same to him.
He's done like everything else on Earth, you know, and so this is like it. Like, he's experienced it all, and you know, obviously he has like a dark outcome in the movie and that story particularly, but like that, I don't know. That isn't to say that there's not like a relevance there, and you know, like, even absolutely, in the movie, he's like he like
that line, pleasure and pain indistinguishable, you know. Yeah, it's fucking great.
Have you read that, by the way, Hellbound Heart, the book?
I picked it up in the airport just 2 days ago. I was looking at it, I was like, honestly, it's embarrassing, awesome, but dude, I was just like, holy shit, I didn't even know that this was really based on a book, that Hellraiser was on a book.
It's so good. I've read about, I think, three or four of Clive Barker's books. I'm reading this one called Imagica right now. It's like 700 pages, and I'm trying to pummel through it. But
jeez, yeah,
incredible. He's an incredible writer.
I'm gonna read that Hellbound Heart for sure.
Yeah, yeah, and I was gonna say, like, it very much. I remember when we were communicating about the album, I got you to get I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream.
Oh, wonderful! Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up because Yoshino, I know, has read that too now.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah. So the one of the new Black Magnet songs, Floating in Nothing, is very heavily based on that book, and kind of my personal connection and takeaway from that on its relation to my life and my existence, I guess.
In what way? You mean like floating in purgatory?
yeah, kind of like like, I don't know. It was one of those books that it left like a pretty everlasting impact on me. And it's like, you know, I don't think I can unread it. Like, I might not ever be the same after it, after just,
yeah, that, I feel that way too. I was like, why the fuck did this dude tell me to read this? This is so fucked.
That's awesome. You're welcome.
Oh yeah. That
it was a book. Like, when I was reading it, I didn't like it. And then after I finished it, I just loved it. Like the day after I read it, I was like, that was fucking amazing. But when I was reading it, I was like, fuck this. This is sick.
But like, I don't know. It was one of those things that it kind of like, you know, kind of like the Twilight Zone episode. Like, are you just a monkey in a cage, like living your life like blind, sort of a thing? Like, is this like, or like, what's it going to be like after I die? And like, I see like what's really underneath it all. Like, you know, am I in a simulation? That sort of thing. Like, I think that had that's really what I took away from it and what I was kind of going for with the Black Magnet song, Floating in Nothing.
Yoshino, I think I might've brought this up to you before, but that story, you can like take it literally as there's this concept about artificial intelligence that people who are really in artificial intelligence and believe that it's going to be sentient and stuff. Do you remember me talking about this, Yoshino?
I think we talked about this. Uh-huh.
James, I wanted to run it by you, but they just have a real abridged version is basically that if AI does become sentient at that point, whatever, and like all knowing, whatever, it will know every single person who ever tried to get in the way of developing AI, or kind of like was an impetus to its creation, and it will punish those people. And it will
it's
be,
just
you know,
like book, man.
Exactly. So like, that's what I'm saying. Like, that was like the literal interpretation. When I read the book, I was like, this is what it is. It's like, this is what the AI is going to do if it fucking takes over or something.
It's like,
had you heard that
it's
before?
Like the machine is keeping the subjects, the people alive to, you know, conduct experiments on it pretty much and like, yeah, like punish it and like learn more about it. And that's why it's killed everyone else off as keep them alive.
To
keep,
it's, yeah, it's keep, super interesting.
Keep making itself its own AI, yeah. You know, more AI yeah. than AI, but it has to have humans to make it learn more. Like, fuck, it's fucking crazy.
Yeah it's really a troubling book.
Totally. Yeah, it definitely is. But very
and like the author Harlan Ellison, his interviews are really worth watching because he's just kind of like a, you know, almost like a trouble starter kind of guy, and just he's funny. There's a lot of learning to do about him.
I feel like that book, he almost has almost like a religious kind of parable feel to it, where he's picked these individual characters for their attributes they had, like the, you know, the different yeah. people and the, you know what I mean? Like
definitely. Yeah.
I can almost see it in that kind of way of like almost this parable. It's really interesting.
And it's like the machine, like, or like what the computer turns them into, sort of a thing too. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. It's like their individual punishments based on like their life. It's like, that's exactly what I mean. It's like a story from the Bible. If the Bible was a cyberpunk novella.
totally.
Cyberpunk novella. I like that. Yeah.
I like, you brought it up a couple times, this idea of dark being unknowingness. Like, that's really well said. Like, people don't like unknowingness, but really when you strip it down, unknowingness is nothing to be scared of or anything.
It's,
people just
it's
make
to be
people
excited
uncomfortable.
About. Yeah.
Yeah, like, exactly. I mean, that's like, where all the shit is. Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
And that's like,
I don't know who it was. Go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, that's the whole reason I am into art and music at all, because it's so, it's like the maximum, like avenue to take into unknown territory. And you know, yeah. it's like, that's what's so,
it's like the vehicle. Yeah,
exactly. It's what's so empowering and, infinite and magical about it all, you know? And that's why whenever I, you know, first inklings getting into art, I knew it had to be my entire life, or I couldn't settle for anything else, you know?
Yeah.
I couldn't settle for less.
Yeah, I feel.
I used to say I'm just doing experiments on myself. Like I'm a science. Like I'm using art, but like art is kind of like a science, and the science is actually just studying myself or something like that. I've always thought of it that way in some regard.
Yeah, I've always tried to think of like as far as like unknowing stuff, in relation to art, and like almost like a an interdimensional way. Like there's like multiple different dimensions of unknowing things always occurring, which I think relates to consciousness too. And it's a matter of me aligning myself and allowing myself to be susceptible to accessing that and believing in myself that I can find that stuff. And that's just kind of like a little mental visual of maybe when I have writer's block or whatever, and I'm a little bit stuck, I can kind of metaphor can help me snap out of it.
Yeah. Alan Watts, I think it was, who used the term the pregnant void, which was like kind of my first encounter
of the
unknown or of the void being like full of everything. Mm-hmm. And then I don't know if it was Mitch or somebody else or whatever who brought up that similar concept of kind of like going into that void to bring things out. And then I can't remember who exactly, but this idea that every single thing that exists in the world existed there first, like to think about it, like, in such a practical term,
like
in practical ways, like exactly like the chair you sat on, like the bed you slept, every single item, thinking of that item at one time was an idea in the head of its creator. And that, where was it before it was in that idea in the head? It was just in the void. So like you can start seeing the whole world and everything you interact with was in the void at some point.
Yeah.
Everything comes from it. And that really flipped everything up for me when
so
I started thinking of
to me.
The entire world is born of the void. Like, you know, I'm holding a CD right now and it's just like the CD was in the void, you know?
right. Well, I mean,
like, where was it? That blows my mind too. It's like, I think when I interviewed Mitch, I tried to like bring this up of like, I want to go to the place where I get that shit, like the Walmart of ideas in the void, like the Walmart, the void Walmart or whatever. Like, how do I get there more often?
The Arby's of ideas.
Yeah.
that's the next book.
The Velveeta cheese and processed roast beef of the world of ideas.
Yeah, I'll take two in a drive-thru.
Well, and I think that really relates to, like thought causation stuff of like you were talking about stuff coming out of the void, like a chair or CD or whatever, is it was like, that's a end result of thoughts going into action, becoming into physical form out of, essentially the void or consciousness or nothing almost, And
yeah,
that's something that's
how insane is that to think magicians. We're fucking wizards, man.
and it's like, in that thought, like, God, how could you ever not have an idea, or like, how could you ever like not be obsessed with keeping creating or keeping your development going when that stuff is, so present and viable and on your mind? And for me, like thinking along those terms is like, it's part of like what keeps me going and keeps me excited is just because it's infinite and unending. And I feel like a lot of people don't allow themselves the space to allow that many of open-ended thoughts to exist day to day, or they would just like, not feel like they would have control over their lives or over their mind or over their whatever.
Yeah.
Well, but for me, that's so fucking liberating and so freeing.
Totally.
That is inspiring and keeps me going. So mm-hmm. That makes sense.
Yeah, definitely. No, it definitely makes sense. I mean, going back to Hermeticism, the first principle is mentalism, right?
Right.
So, I mean, essentially like whatever, so for instance, if you're having a conversation with someone that they're deeming like, that your work being dark or, giving some sort of stigma around what they hear from your artwork, right? From your music. And it's really just a projection of their reality, being projected onto you.
I want people to gain their own, understanding and communication from the work, because that's the point, I don't know what all of my favorite bands or artists were thinking about when I look at their paintings or listen to their songs. I take it for my interpretation of it, sort of thing. So, but I guess when people downplay it because it's dark or something, it just kind of seems dishonest to me.
Totally. Yeah. Well, guys, thanks for doing this. I mean, do you guys have any like final words or anything, or like anything you guys want to touch upon?
I thanks for having me. This has been like a lot of fun, cool conversation. I think we hit on really cool topics that I wanted to touch on. I know like it's really cool, this triangulation we have here, because James and I have been talking and finding out that we have a lot of these similarities that you and I, Yosh, have as well. So I know like Mitch is kind of a connection between it all. I don't know, James, have you known Mitch beforehand or not? But I know like he's a fan of yours, goes to your shows and stuff like that.
I wanted to ask
what you got coming up next, really, because I know I'll just put it out there that you're playing guitar with Greg on the 11th of November here in LA for Greg's first solo show. And this goes back to something we said earlier about
for the audience.
Yeah.
Greg Pusciato.
Yeah. Your attitude, going back to what we said earlier about how good, positive you are and stuff, is that me and Greg were on the phone a few weeks ago or whatever, and he was talking about like, I have a few options for the guitar player, and he named you, and I was just like, just stop, it's him, he's the fucking one. You're not gonna find anybody who's gonna like put more effort and who's gonna be better. And I particularly brought up your vibe. I'm like, dude, he's the guy who's gonna be like so hyped, we're all gonna have a fucking blast that night, like.
Dude, get thank him. You, man.
And I almost guarantee he knows all the songs already.
Dude, I really, really appreciate it. I am really excited about that. Yeah, yeah. I think that set list is like 17 songs. And
ooh,
we kinda
really?
We kind of confirmed like maybe 10 days ago that I'd be doing it. So I've been grinding it pretty hard lately.
I you're gonna crush it though. I mean, this is gonna be awesome. I'm excited. I'm really excited. I mean, it's gonna It's a cool lineup. Like, we got all the homies now. Like, yeah, Brandon Trace will be there and shit. Fuck, so, yeah. Like, really cool, man. Do you have any other shows, though?
Yeah, so tomorrow Black Magnet is playing with Kin Mode, Frail Body, and Chat Pile in Oklahoma City.
Wow. I wish I was in Oklahoma City, honestly. Right, that's gonna be a sick show.
Yeah, that's like, it's like a really, really good lineup. So we have that. And then Black Magnet is doing a tour, like a 3-week tour in March. I think it's 20 shows with King Yosef. And that's like Midwest, East Coast, and like Southern US. And then, you know, like kind of going back to Body Prophecy and how long it took to get out and be recorded. Since then, Black Magnet's written like 16 new songs, I think. So we're going to record in July, I think, of this year. Yeah. Record a new album. And over the past year, I've had two, which I think you met them, Jesse. I've gained two band members. So I recorded the first two albums by myself, but we've kind of been writing more as a unit now. Mm-hmm. And I guess, I mean, I'm still the predominant songwriter, but it's definitely like evolved and expanded, like to a kind of to a three piece where we're all working together. And I'm ready to get this one recorded. I'm super, super excited about that. Yeah. So that, yeah. And yeah, I'll be in LA playing with Greg, which I'm so excited about. Should be killer.
That's awesome, man.
The new record is available like through us at shows or through our label, 20 bucks spend, 20bucksspend.com. We'll have a bunch of new shirts with Jesse's art on them that are being printed this week. We'll have those online probably through our Bandcamp.
Oh yeah.
And definitely at our shows. I'll definitely mail you guys. I'll bring some when I'm out there, Jesse, in a couple
Great.
Weeks. Yeah, I think, awesome. I think I'm driving out there on the 4th, on Friday.
You're fourth. Driving?
Yeah, I think I'm driving because I want some of my gear.
Right on. How long of a drive will that be?
About 18 hours.
Okay.
Oh, wow. Damn. Dedication right there. See, that's a dedication.
I mean,
we're talking about.
I could have flown. It's just like, I don't know, man. Like, I don't mind like burning some rubber. And yeah, And, you know, Greg has a ton of equipment. I think we're renting a bunch of stuff for that show. But, like, I just at least wanted, like, two of my guitars. And he wanted me to bring some of my pedals. So I think I got to drive.
Nice. Well, very awesome, cool. Man. Well, I'm excited that we get to share your work with, you know, everyone that listens to the pod and stuff, man. Like,
Yeah.
Music's awesome. So
thank you so much.
I listen to it all the time.
That's awesome, man. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like I said, I mean, we have like I said, 16 new songs. So, and really, I mean, right when I was done recording Body Prophecy, I just started writing, and that's probably for the next one. And that's probably kind of what kept me from feeling stale about the project in general. So yeah, I have about 2 years worth of work that is going to get recorded this summer.
Wow. That's incredible, man.
Super exciting.
Very excited for
more stuff.
Yeah. All right, man. Well, hey, thanks for coming on the pod, guys. Really.
Yeah, this is killer, man. I feel like we could have talked about any particular subject for about 3 more hours a piece.
Yeah, for sure, for real.
Yeah, yeah. All right, guys. Well, hope you two have a good day. And
yeah,
you too. As well, thanks again. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thank you. Peace. I'll see you soon, Jesse.
Yeah, for sure. Later, bro.
Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, aka Justin Dosher Hopkins. YouTube and creative support is by Tyler Scully. Social media assistance is by Noah Wainwright. Thanks so much for tuning in, and see you next time.